Hello, my name is Ray Ebert.
I'm Monique Carter.
And this is the Fontana Unlocked podcast.
How are you?
I'm good. Welcome back.
I know. I feel like these last couple of weeks, like Monday was like, I mean, not Monday, January was like a long January. And now February, March is like,
yeah,
fast.
We're in the middle of March.
I
was going to say the middle of February. No, we're in the middle of March.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
Which basically means the year's over.
Yeah, pretty much it's going to be 4th of July next week. And then we're going to be having turkey. And then yes. It's Christmas time.
Yes.
Well, I don't have a question for you this week, but I do have some stuff I want to share, and it might I think you're going to find a little bit interesting. So over the weekend, I had the opportunity to attend South by Southwest in Austin, Texas.
Mm-hmm.
And if you haven't heard of South by Southwest, go take a look, SXSW. It started back in the late 80s as a music festival. It was kind of trying to mirror an event that was going back east. And it has over the years transitioned into more of a technology expose or, you know, release party of many different technologies. It's still got an enormous music and film presence. Many bands are discovered at South by Southwest, many new films. It's kind of almost like our Cannes Film Festival domestically, where a lot of films are released. Many films are being released this week because South by Southwest is continuing on for the rest of the week. But it's the technology piece that I went out there for. And a couple of things that we've talked about a number of times were really front and center. So this is the first year that South by Southwest has had an AI track.
Oh, interesting.
And so I spent a bit of time, you know, learning more about AI and a number of things. The three technologies that really jumped out at me as interesting, both personally and professionally, one is the AI, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that in a second. But quantum computing. We've all kind of, I think some of us have heard about it, thinking that it's kind of Star Trek-y, you know, kind of in the future. I won't say Star Wars because Star Wars was in the past, right? A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
Far, far away.
But Star Trek is in our future, theoretically. And so anyway, so quantum computing is a thing it's kind of here. It's almost ready for prime time, and there's some potential impacts for us as individuals as well as a local government. And then the other topic was augmented reality, AR.
Mm.
And you may have seen Apple had those goggles that came out a couple weeks ago. And so that was demonstrated in a number of ways throughout the event. But so AI, first of all, I just really this is a PSA for everybody. So get your families together and come up with a code word.
Yes. I know where he's going with this. This is very important.
It is important. And this isn't even a joke. So, and I called my family over the weekend, like, hey, we're coming up with code words. So it takes about 10 minutes to train an AI to replicate your voice. And oh, by the way, you're a podcast host. So we have 10 minutes of your voice and mine. So it would take literally no effort whatsoever for someone to clone our voices and then make a phone call to one of our family members and say, Grandma, I'm stuck in wherever, I need some cash. And Grandma's going to hear your voice asking for this cash. And what's Grandma going to do, right? What are many grandmas going to do?
She's going to write a check.
Yeah, and they're going to have to talk, maybe, you know, kind of talk her through going to the store and buying a gift card or something. But the risk is there. And it's the effort is so trivial that I think every family should run out and create a code word. And the purpose is, if you get that call, if Grandma gets that call from Monique and, you know, asking for money, Grandma says, Monique, what's the code word? And the code word is, you know, Monique, right? Mm-hmm. Obviously. Whatever it is. So now Grandma knows she's actually talking to you, and maybe she has a more realistic conversation as opposed to, you know, the one-way conversation that's going to occur. So that's my first PSA. Just go out, come up with a family code word, and be prepared for this potential scenario where you get these strange calls. I told my dad about these. I'm like, I don't answer calls anyway. And I'm like, yeah, okay. But, you know, you never know. So that's my first thing. But AI is so interestingly, I'm going to really try to keep this as short as I can, but South by Southwest was where social media got its footing. Twitter, when it was called Twitter, had their release party at South by Southwest back in 2006 or 2007. And over the years, a number of social media companies have had their kind of coming out party at South by Southwest. It became known as where social media kind of got its ground footing. And they're not super proud of that.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, they've kind of recognized the toxicity that social media has brought to society. They had hoped that it would bring people together, bring organizations and groups and communities together, and open up lines of communication. And it has done that for many of us, I think. Anyway, but it's also brought this toxicity to the world, mm-hmm. and South by Southwest recognizes that. And so their approach to AI, while they're embracing it, and they really want to support where AI can go from a social improvement tool or productivity tool or however you look at AI, they recognize the danger. And so they're really kind of having a kind of dual path approach to promoting AI here. It could be good, it could be revolutionary, and it's also could be really bad and really dangerous. So basically everybody take those two takeaways. And I think we've had that conversation a number of times.
Yes.
All right, enough of that.
All right.
Who is this?
Who are you?
I don't know. I think I'm sitting on the wrong side.
So just for folks who don't know, folks at home who don't know, this gentleman has been around. He's not new. So he's been around actually behind the scenes since the inception, even the thought process of this podcast. Who are you, sir?
I'm Albert Sida, and I currently oversee the KFON TV department, which is our local government channel here in the city of Fontana.
AKA known as Media Services.
Media Support Services.
So there's I don't know that people knew that we have like the service what you oversee. So tell us a little bit about what KFON is. What is Media Support Services?
Well, the funny thing is we're the South by Southwest of City Fontana now. yes. We used to be strictly just a channel-based department. But as COVID happened and a lot of people started using web cameras and conferencing and all that stuff and Teams, so now we kind of oversee anything that has a camera, a mic, or whatever. We oversee all that. We help troubleshoot all that. We help set up conferences, meetings, in addition to still running the TV channel for City of Fontana.
What channel is the TV channel?
Well, it depends on what you got. We're on Spectrum. We're on AT&T UVerse. We're on Verizon Vios. If you have Spectrum, we're Channel 3. So that's the easiest one to know.
Yeah.
And in AT&T, I think you just got to go to channel like 999. What is it, Brandon? 99. And then you just select City of Fontana.
I think there's a live, a web-based channel too.
Yeah. So we're also on Watch KFON. Online, and then we also have a video on demand. So if you missed any of our amazing programming or city council meeting, you can go to our video on demand and just watch it live.
So this is where we're calling this episode the gray area of government. I think we kind of came up with that because it's an industry that you don't expect to be housed within a municipal setting per se. So basically, you're a TV producer, a mm-hmm. podcast producer, an AV tech, a sound engineer, and like a lighting technician. I don't know these official terms, but that's kind of in essence, you guys are like the Swiss Army knife of all things video, like media-ish. Visual. Yeah. Yeah. So, and I, you guys, many may know that I oversee marketing and communications, which means I talk to Albert generally every day.
The time. I like to think Monique as my like second boss.
He says that with the facetious voice, but he really does kind of help save my bacon on various different occasions we're not oftentimes given a lot of time and room to do things. It's just, I need this done tomorrow, and we have to sit down and strategize of how to get it done tomorrow. So tell us a little bit about your background.
So want me to start like the day of my birth or
okay.
Let's talk about your day of your birth.
Yes. Yeah. Just because I think this is a cool story. Albert, tell them about the day of your birth.
So everybody, obviously knows me as Albert, but my original name was supposed to be Alberto, because I'm Mexican. But the nurse forgot to put the O on my birth certificate. And so when they went and gave it to my dad to sign off, he told the nurse, "Hey, you're missing the O." And then there's, "Oh, don't worry, I'll go change it, I'll bring it back." And my dad was kind of over it, so he was like, "You know what? It's fine. It sounds good. You signed it. Boom." So now my name's Albert. But I'm not going to lie, I prefer Albert than Alberto's.
Really?
I feel like I would have gotten a lot of, like, burrito jokes growing up.
Oh, yeah. Because,
Alberto's the restaurant.
And you probably would have gone by Albert anyway.
Yeah.
I think it was the funniest story when he first said that. I laughed so hard. And so, yeah. So his dad was like, I'm over it. Just, we're going to name you whatever.
Whatever you put on there is fine. It's Bob, Jim.
Yes.
And the funnier part is my family actually calls me Betito. So like the nickname for Alberto in Spanish is Beto. Mm-hmm. But my uncle's name is Alberto. So they call him Beto. And so since I was smaller, they call me Betito.
So. So really, they're just calling, they're adding the name in that you were supposed to. Got it.
So everybody wins.
Yes. Yeah. So, but actually tell us about your professional background, because this is not something, like I said, this is a bit of Swiss Arming in here.
So I originally wanted to be in the medical field as soon as I graduated high school. So I went to Valley College, San Bernardino Valley College, because they had a good like nursing program / a good medical basis. So in case you wanted to advance that career, you could. So I went with the intentions of being in the medical field. I took a death and dying class, and then I volunteered at the local Arrowhead Hospital. And yeah, I found out real quick that wasn't for me. And then I switched gears. I was like, you know what? What sounds cool in the medical field? And then I ran into psychology. So I took a couple of psychology courses. It sucks that on my sixth course, my professor was like, hey, just so you guys know, like, you really need a PhD to get like an actual career in psychology. I kid you not. I literally went to the counselor like the next day and I was like, I'm out. But all my life, I wanted to be an artist. Like, I actually wanted to be like a cartoonist.
Mm.
But, and I thought I was good, but it was more that my mom thought I was good. And I realized real quick when I got to middle school and I saw, and I did like an art class and I see the other kids, I was like, yeah, I'm not that good. So I kind of quit, but I always wanted to be an artist. And so when I was like, well, what am I going to do? I was like, well, I want to do something in the arts. I have no talent. So so then I had to like dig deep, like, man, what can an artist do that doesn't require talent? And then like I always told, like, I wouldn't say I told like lies or whatever, but I told like tall tales.
Mm.
And so I always like telling stories. And
I like how
it's not a lie, it's just a fib.
Yeah.
It's just not true, that's all.
And so the first thing that came to mind was like movies, and I was always
because they lie in movies.
Yeah, they do. There's tall tales, you know? And so I was like, you know what? I'll do that. And then I started getting into movies, and I was like, I want to be a director.
Mm.
So then I luckily, San Bernardino Valley College also has a good, like, video, TV program as well. And so it was easy just to switch over to that. And then I transferred to Cal State Northridge to their film program. And then, yeah, I got my my degree in CSUN in the film program over there.
Oh, so you have, you're a legit professional, like. You like filming. Yeah. You did the whole nine yards.
Yeah, and the goal was always Hollywood. The goal was always Hollywood. It just
so how did you end up?
It didn't play like that.
Did you watch the Oscars the other night?
Oh yeah, of course. Yeah.
And did the right wing film win?
Yeah, I think Oppenheimer was deserved the best picture. I'm always surprised to see what the Academy decides was a good movie. Because sometimes I think it's political.
Mm-hmm.
I was shocked that Poor Things got so many awards. I thought they were going to hate it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's not a very watchable movie to most people, I guess.
I was going
to
say, I haven't seen it. I saw Oppenheimer, but I didn't see
it. I don't think
you'll
like it, but go ahead and watch it. It's pretty good.
Really?
Some people liked it.
And so how did you end up here at City of Fontana?
Okay, so when I did start going to Valley College, one of my good friends was dating a girl that was in Healthy Fontana. And at the time, I was actually I applied to, like, work at the mall at Tommy Hilfiger. And then right before they, like, called me in to, like, schedule me or whatever, he told me, like, hey, dude, working for the city is awesome. They work around your schedule. And it beats, you know, doing, like, flipping burgers or mm-hmm. you know, doing mall
folding,
jobs.
Folding sweaters.
Yeah, folding sweaters all day. So I was like, all right. So I applied. Luckily, I got into community services. And so I started at community services. And then legit, I had no knowledge of KFON. I didn't have much knowledge of the city, to tell you the truth. I just, you know, knew the parks at the time. And then I got lucky because I think Fontana has always had really good leadership. And so my supervisor at the time, his name was Rob Bach. He took a liking to me. Why? I don't know. But he took a good liking to me.
The stories you told.
Yeah, maybe.
The tall tales.
And he let me know, like, hey, just so you know, he found out that I was going to CSUN or whatever. And he's like, hey, there's a TV department here. You should probably work there instead. And so about like a year or so, I got to transition over to KFON as a part-time. And then I was like, oh, this is pretty cool. You know, I get to get some experience here. And then when I finished school, I was like, you know what? I might stay like one more year at KFON, and then I'm going to join my buddies in Hollywood and do some PA work or whatnot.
What's a PA?
Production assistant. That's literally like the easiest job you can get in Hollywood. You're pretty much doing all the grunt work.
But that's like the entry point.
Yeah, that's the entry point. Mm. And then you can move up. Believe it or not, if you're taping in a film set, you're up there.
Oh, yeah, interesting. Yeah.
So I was going to just stay a year. And then a full-time position opened up. Everyone encouraged me to apply. I said, you know what? Fine. So I applied. I got the position. And then the same thing. Like, I was like, you know, just a year of experience. I'm going to make my way to Hollywood. And then, you know, life happens. You know, I got a spouse. I got two kids. I had a mortgage out of nowhere.
Did you name them correctly?
Funny story, though.
Of course.
So... I did a wonderful strategy that I recommend to everybody. So I wanted to name my son Kylo off of the Star Wars character, Kylo Ren.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, I knew that my wife was going to be like, no, dude, like, you know, I want Ryan or something. I don't know. So I was like, okay. So I hit her with like three horrible names. So I was like, I want Kakarot, Vegeta.
Vegeta?
Yeah. Dude, oh. I was like, and then finally when I said Kylo, she's all, stop. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. And I was like, oh, the strategy worked.
Did you really go Dragon Ball Z on her?
Oh, yeah. See? Ashi, you got the reference.
Yes.
But no lie, I would have preferred Kakarot, but, you know, I'll settle for Kylo.
I was going to say, your child would have never lived that down.
Yeah.
There's too many ways you can go sideways with that.
Yeah. But yeah, life happened, and the city was an awesome place to work at if you do have a family, because obviously if you haven't seen the video that I'm showcased in.
Yes.
The benefits are wonderful here in the city of Fontana. And so I was like, you know what? Let me make a career out of it. And luckily enough, that was probably one of the best decisions I made, because I'm getting opportunity after opportunity now. Ever since I decided to say, like, I'm going to stick around, literally, like, the gates have opened here.
So that's something that I kind of want to draw attention to, is that one, Albert didn't know that any of this existed, but to then say, once you get here, there's opportunities for advancement. You just really had to kind of say yes to the opportunities. I know Ray has mentioned it before when we interviewed Matt, is that you got to say yes. And so even though you may not necessarily fully understand, or like, let me just give it a shot. Let me try it. Let me excel and really, you know, sort of apply myself to it to get to the, I think you were mentioning, you try to tell your daughter, say yes. Say yes to new opportunities. Yeah. Say yes to things that you may not completely fully grasp it, just so that you have an opportunity to learn. So opportunities, guys, you got to be prepared for them.
So you have, you had and have friends in the industry.
I currently have a ton of friends in the industry.
And they're making movies. They're doing all the things that you're doing.
Believe it or not, most of them are in reality TV, just because there's so many, and the job cycle of that is very constant.
Mm.
While like a film or another type of TV show, they have a set schedule and they don't really film that much. So most of them are actually in reality TV.
But are they doing, are they directing? Are they
running the show? They wish. They wish, I'll tell you that. No, they're doing a little bit above PA work. They're doing maybe talent coordination. There's some that made it up to being a grip. A grip is what we were talking about earlier about like taping and getting the cables ready and whatnot. But for the most part, it's tough. It's a very unionized industry. And there's a lot of steps you have to take just to get into one position. And then to, like, advance in that same position takes a long time. It comes down to, like, you got to know the right person. If you don't know the right person there, you're really not going to move up that much. Even one of my friends that's one of the more successful person as far as getting job after job, it was because one of the main people took a liking to him. So whenever they do a production, he's one of the first guys they call.
Mm.
But I mean, if he didn't take a liking to that guy, he would have to continue hustling and trying to get himself into a show or a film.
And do
No, go ahead.
Do they work consistently?
No, it's usually like 3 months at a time. They take maybe like a month off and then try to find another TV or film to jump on. And then that's another 2-3 months. So no, it's not steady work. You have to be a real hustler to be in the industry.
So what I'm hearing you say then is you do all the things.
Yeah.
You get to touch the cameras, you get to touch the editors, you get to touch the sound, you get to touch the headphones, you get to interact with the talent. You you have a full-time job with benefits. Why not come to a city and do what you do?
Yeah. Especially for those people that aren't as, I don't want to say creatively driven, but that don't have the aspirations of being the next Quentin Tarantino. Mm. Like, if you want to be in the industry, which I think it's a very appealing industry to a lot of people, government is a good place to look at, because almost every government has a PEG channel. And if they don't have...
What's a PEG channel?
So a PEG channel is local government channel that gets funding from your cable-based company. So you can have a channel for your TV.
So it's another word for a public access channel. Yes. Or a public channel.
Yeah, okay. Pretty much. But it's run by the city. A lot of other agencies actually contract out their PEG channel. They use the PEG funds to contract out and then have them run it. We're fortunate enough here in the city of Fontana that we don't contract out. They decided to invest in the department. And so I'm fortunate enough to have a department instead of having it contracted out like some other agencies do.
But you have more than just a department. You have a studio.
Yeah. I have a little TV studio over there, about to get a massive studio pretty soon, hopefully, knock on wood. But yeah, we literally have all the toys that you'll find in any industry.
So, and that kind of takes me to kind of the next part of the conversation. Because everybody sort of assumes you have to go to Hollywood to do this, it's kind of hard. If you're local and you're trying to really start to beef up your resume, start to get some of your experience in, what are some of the recommendations? I know we talked about in the past before about the volunteer program.
Yeah. So one thing that I think people don't understand if you're trying to get into this industry is you're not just competing with people within the state, which California is massive, right? Massive. But you're dealing with those Midwest people that have that Hollywood dream as well. And like you'll be surprised like how many people try to make it into the industry, but they all go to LA. It's a lot. I mean, we have it here. So to touch on what you mentioned, which was our volunteer program, last year we had staffing issues where I feel like a lot of other people might have the GoPro just turned off, but it's okay. A lot of people would have just said, hey, you know what? I don't have the resources. I'm just going to make sure the ship doesn't sink. And I took it as an opportunity. I said, look, we don't have the staffing that we need. I want to push the boat forward. You know, I don't want to just stay stagnant. So I came up with the idea with making like a volunteer program. And then through that, we got a bunch of local talent that came from at any level. There was a couple of people that just started college, or some people that are about to finish college. There are some people that were thinking about being in the industry. And so we got a little bit of everything in our volunteer program. But I know for you, like, you can email any of them. I know for a fact that they took a lot out of that volunteer program, just because, like we said before, they get here, you get to touch everything, the camera, the lighting, the mics, editing, whatever it is, we let you at least have the opportunity to try things out here.
So from a, you know, person who may or may not advocate for influencers, you know, it's a thing. What would you say as a person who's looking to try and come into the industry but thinks that they only can go to Hollywood? That's for me, that's a quick shout out to try your public access channel. People.
Yeah. Yeah.
So probably most cities have a public access channel.
Yeah. 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 And I think.
And there's 500 some odd cities in California alone.
Right.
Yeah. And I was going to say, and you can win awards too, in our industry. There's competitions as well. So if you do have like that competitive spirit, you can still have it here and you can still compete. And every city technically has like a government channel. They have a city council meeting that probably should be aired, or they have a contract with some company that you could probably join. But yeah, I think public access is a perfect route for anybody.
And if your wife allowed you to think about leaving the city because of our great benefits, so if she decided, all right, I got a new job, and so maybe you can think about, you know, getting achieving your dream of going to Hollywood, is anything that you've done here applicable and transferable? Would it help you on your resume?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, 100%. I actually own my own, like, little production company. I only got better at making short films because of what I learned here at KFON. Like I mentioned before, I always wanted to be a director. There is a lot of tie-in to running a department and directing a film. There's the annoying stuff that you don't think about, but you really need to be aware of. And like, you wouldn't even get that experience unless you're in some kind of supervisor role. And so I translated that into making, you know, when I make my short films and whatnot. And the cool thing about here too is you can try stuff. I mean, we do a 3-camera setup. Okay, doesn't mean I can't try a 5-camera setup, but 2-camera setup. And then that gives me knowledge, like, oh, you know what? You know what's a really good angle, a good scene that we can do? We put the camera up here, put the lighting over there.
Nice. Drone footage.
Yeah, footage.
All the things.
Like a filmmaker's playground almost.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
So one of the things that I think that we have talked about in the past is the thing, at least that I appreciate, that we can try things, that even this as an example of, you know, the podcast, this was very much an idea. It says, hey,
I was in the center of the film industry for a couple days, and I was walking around going, hi, my name is Ray Ebert. I'm a podcaster. I don't work for a city. I'm a podcast. No, I'm kidding.
But it's interesting, though. But I do appreciate that, because Albert and I, and even the rest of the team that you guys can't see behind the cameras, we have these meetings and we're like, okay, I got an idea. Mm-hmm. this is what I want to try. And we'll see how this works. And understanding full well that visually, maybe it takes us a couple of tries to do something. But I appreciate that the city gives us a chance to give it a shot and really see what works and what doesn't work, and really helps us, all of us professionally, which I think helps the city in turn, is that the better that we get, then the better that the city becomes. So I that's kind of my little, you know, my shout out to all of the things that we do kind of behind the scenes.
With one small caveat. So we're not making independent films here.
No.
You know, everything we do is very much focused on either telling a story about the city or promoting an activity by the city, or, you know, providing the messaging for the city. So within those constraints, we have a lot of flexibility to be creative.
As long as the end goal is informing the residents of something that's taking place in the city or happening at the city, is always the goal. But that's cool, because, like, if you just take that sentence and if you can think outside the box, there's amazing things you can do and still tell the residents what's going on with your city.
Absolutely. And if you look, I think a great example, we talked about it last week, what is the state of the city? Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different ways we're telling stories through film and through media.
So what would you tell, if you had to, because I recognize I'm looking at people and they're making faces at me, what would you say as a maybe a potential new graduate or somebody looking to enter the film industry, what would be your sort of parting comments needing to let them know, or words of wisdom?
Well, one, always say yes.
Yes.
And no, yeah, you should look locally to see what you have first before you look outside that. Mm. Again, I was very fortunate enough that Fontana believes in their media department and they invest in their media department. That's not to say other cities don't. And it's a perfectly good avenue to go to. And like what Ray was trying to like mention earlier, if government's not your thing, it's still a good place to get a foundation. And then you can go off to Hollywood still, and you can probably go with more experience.
Mm. And then be able to say, I was able to make government interesting.
Exactly. Which I think is a challenge on its own, but I love it. I love having a challenge.
And if you can do that, you can tell any story.
Seriously. Yes. You can tell all kinds of tales.
Well, so you talked about in the not too distant future, you're hoping for a new new studio. You're relatively new to this role, even though you've been with the city for quite a while. Yeah. Where's Fontana, or where's KFON going?
Ooh, I mean, it's like limitless where I think Fontana and KFON's going. I think we're barely knocking on the door as far as making entertainment quality programming for the residents. We're brewing up some stuff, though. We're brewing up some stuff. We're going to get a massive TV studio that I feel that
I wouldn't use the word massive. I don't want anyone to think that, you know.
It's huge, though. It's huge.
Okay. But compared to what you have
today. Yeah, compared to what I have now. I feel like it's going to benefit the PD department. I feel it's going to benefit any department here as far as getting their information out. We're hoping to have, like, a cooking show pretty soon. We're trying to do sports programming with our local high schools, which, I mean, it's ridiculous the amount of that's the number one thing I get requested is sports programming from residents, from employees, from even people. As soon as they hear about KFON, like, oh, can I check out the A.B. Miller game or something? Mm-hmm. So we're hoping to get into sports programming. We're trying to start a trivia show for our residents. I mean, we have a lot of stuff coming up, hopefully, in the near future.
So that sounds like a lot of content. How much time do you need to fill?
So, believe it or not, we're a 24-hour, 7-day channel.
Okay.
So there has to be content at all times. It's tough. It's tough to fill 24 hours in 7 days. And the one thing you don't want to do is, like, give the perception to the people that all we do is make flyers or something, or make PowerPoint slides. I want to show them that, you know, we're invested in them and we're trying to show as much content as possible. But right now we're getting there. I think there's going to be a year where we're making over 100+ hours of original content with KFON TV.
That's awesome.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week is tough. Like that's a lot of, and that's no commercials. That's not like, we don't have advertisers. So this is all us like putting that together. So.
And take a look at KTLA, for example, just to pick on one local channel, you know, and go watch them at 2 a.m. There's not a lot of compelling, you know, content there. So it's a challenge, and it sounds like you're up to it.
Two things, though, I really wanted to get out there. Going back to, like, equipment and stuff like that, we do have a RED camera, which is a digital film camera.
Mm-hmm. And that's like a 4K camera or something?
It's a 6K camera.
6K.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Just to name a couple of highlights just so people know out there. The new Power Rangers movie was filmed in a RED camera. Rebel Moon, which isn't that good of a show, was filmed in a RED camera, though. And then the new Amazon movie Roadhouse with Conor McGregor.
Yeah.
That was filmed in a RED camera. We have that here at KFON. And guess what? If you want to learn about it, you can come and volunteer pretty soon and get your hands on it. And then one more other thing was I want to just kind of like, I guess, my soapbox here. If you were to look up a guy named Kane Parsons, he's a 17-year-old kid that got signed by A24 to make a feature film. If you go and watch what he made in the YouTube series and why A24 took notice, is because he took time to invest in a story to tell something entertaining. Yeah, maybe he didn't have the best equipment, but that didn't stop him from trying to tell a very good story with what the resources he has. And I think that's a good thing to approach when you want to be in this industry. At the end of the day, like, you need some kind of development, some kind of story process to really make it. And I think KFON's like an awesome place. Like I said, just take that line of how can we inform the residents, right? And then you can build the whole story around that. Just my little PSA.
Soapbox.
But it's good that it's one of those things that I know Albert and I talk about this a lot is, you know, you need some sort of story. It's sort of the beginning, middle, and end. And in government, there's kind of always going to be something. But you may not receive it in the same way that, you know, somebody else would. So it's our job and kind of all of the creative side of government or the gray area of government is to make sure that we're reaching the residents and the businesses in a way that makes sense to them. And so that's always going to be our goal. So if you see new ways of doing things, new opportunities, it's because that's the goal that we're trying to fulfill.
And I think that the mindset of the short film maker is perfect for us because we have little vignettes, little stories that we need to tell. We need to tell a story about the building across the street or Stage Red or the whatever, right? Everything is a very, you know, tell me in 3 minutes the whole story, right? And so having that mindset of, beginning, middle, end, getting in, getting out, telling the story in a compelling way, I think that's the perfect mindset for what you do. You talked a little bit about the equipment. I had a couple different questions, and I'm trying to both get them out and then also cognizant of time. What else should we cover before we make Albert stop talking?
We have the TV channel, and that was kind of, well, in addition to the TV channel, Albert kind of initially sort of talked about it a little bit. The stuff that you guys also do is all AV inclusive.
Yes.
So that's everything from conference rooms to, you know, computers to, that's everything. So when Albert says you will literally touch everything,
yep,
you will touch everything. So the goal is, even if it's something that you're considering, because I don't know if you guys still have positions open, because I know that was, right, I feel like IT always has positions open. So if that is something that you're interested in, please feel free, because you're going to get that experience.
Sounds like you guys have a lot of fun.
Oh, we have tons of fun. I kind of don't want to say how much fun we have because I might get in trouble, but it's one of the funner departments for sure. Before I get off the volunteer program too, the other thing that you can get out of KFON is live broadcasting. Mm. I don't think there's anywhere you can go and they'll let you get experience on their live broadcasting side. ESPN is not going to let you switch the cameras. I'll tell you that right now. But here, you know, with supervision, I will let you switch the cameras on a live broadcast when we do a planning commission or parks commission. Maybe not city council, but, you know, you will at least get the opportunity to do some sort of live broadcasting, which I think is tremendous experience that you can get that you can't really get anywhere else. I don't think any production company, any TV studio will let you touch their live broadcasting devices.
I'm rethinking my career choices.
Ray's going to be one of the volunteers. We're like, I know you? All right. Well, I think we are out of time.
I think we are. It was a little long. But Albert, so much fun talking to you. I want to hear more about how you're named and how you name your kids in the future. Good stuff. With that, I'm Ray Ebert.
I'm Monique Carter.
And this has been the Fontana Unlocked podcast.
Today it was recorded still in City Hall, but the sound recording and engineering was not done by Albert.
No, it was not.
So I'm going to wrap this all into one. The sound recording and the audio engineering was done by the illustrious Brandon Alcantar. Research and fact checking was done by marketing assistants Ashley Martin and Cecilia Lozano. Ladies and gentlemen, Fontana Unlocked.